Let me just say, on behalf of everyone everywhere, God, we missed Eddie Murphy.
It's showtime, y'all. You love him and I love him. Put your hands together.
Dolemite is my name.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Raider Reviews, the first and only review show on the Raider News Channel. My name is Ben Friedman, and today we're going to be taking a look at a film based on the true story of former comedian Rudy Ray Moore, a film that is also heralded as a return to form for the Saturday Night Live legend that is Eddie Murphy after years of miring around in cinematic filth. Let's take a peek at the Golden Globe nominated, but more importantly, Moscow Award nominated, Dolemite Is My Name.
Hey, that's Durban Martin.
I'm offering you a role in my new motion picture.
You think you could just walk up here and hire me? No.
What if we let you direct?
Released onto Netflix on October 25th, 2019, back when the world was still open for business, and directed by Craig Brewer, the film features an all-star cast beside Murphy and was applauded by critics for being one of the funniest and most uplifting films of the year. It even got to the point where Time Magazine and the National Board of Review named it one of the 10 best films of 2019, putting it in some pretty exclusive company. But did it win over the critic you see before you? Let's find out and kick things off with the good.
Hey, you know, Auntie, I was thinking about putting out
a comedy record.
Comedy? You've been a singer, a shake dancer?
Ha! It's real hard to break in. I do whatever it takes to get in.
I come up with a new character.
Dolemite is my name!
Number one, the setting. On the outside, the setting might not seem like anything that special at all. A typical portrayal of Los Angeles in the 1970s doesn't sound like anything that amazing. The production team on this film really goes above and beyond the call of duty to just really immerse you in the world inhabited by Rudy Ray Moore and all the other characters. Every costume has that flash and pizzazz that you would expect from the 70s, and it creates a great contrast with some of the darker and more rundown set pieces in which some of the film takes place. It's a great and aesthetically pleasing move that helps give the film a much greater feel and helps draw you into the fun and down-to-earth world that these characters inhabit. Number two, the cast. The cast for this movie is, to put it bluntly, star-studded. Some of the finest African-American actors and actresses on the scene assembled and gave some great performances. Aside from Eddie Murphy, we have Keegan-Michael Key, Mike Epps, Craig Robinson, Titus Burgess, Wesley Snipes, and even Chris Rock, meaning that we finally got the Shrek and Madagascar crossover scene we've always wanted. But the one person in my eyes who I think deserves special recognition is Divine Joy Randolph as Lady Reed. She showed a ton of range throughout the entire film, playing a down-on-her-luck character who was helped by Moore and his wild ambitions. She hits all of her points perfectly, and while it may not be a total award-worthy performance, it's a great performance to kickstart her film career, and a perfect way to round out this fun cast that helps take the film to a whole new level. Number three, the music. Like the costume and production design, the music really helps to just amp up the retro factor, and it really helps to set the mood in a lot of scenes in this film. The music is always enjoyable and can often provide a great insight into what the characters are feeling. Considering just how big music was back then, as well as Rudy Ray Moore starting out in a record shop and making normal singing records before moving on to comedy, it's a needed touch that goes a long way. And if you need any more convincing, there's a scene in this film where someone is rocking out in a band using a kazoo, which, as we all know, is the coolest of all musical instruments. But alas, even the kazoo can't save this film from its faults. Let's go to the bad.
If this thing flops, you're gonna be working for free for the rest of your life.
I'm so grateful for what you did for me, cause I never seen nobody that looks like me.
Oh, yeah.
Up there on that big screen.
Number one, the cursing. Now, I know, cursing in films is not an abnormal thing or a bad thing, as it's seen in almost every movie that's not given a G, or in some cases, a PG rating. But with that being said, holy mother of God, there was way too much cursing in this film. There's so much cursing that Quentin Tarantino is telling them to slow down. This film pulled no punches and used no moderation when it came to the swear counter. At first, it didn't bother me. I was fine. But then people started cursing in literally every other sentence, and it kinda got on my nerves. Without the cursing, I felt like the story would have had a lot more weight to it, and I would have felt more invested in the characters instead of having to keep track of how many times they dropped the F-bomb. Cursing is fine in any movie, but you have to know how to use it wisely and effectively in order for an impact to be made instead of just writing it in to satisfy the R rating. And in a way, this kind of goes hand in hand with my next point. Number two, the comedy. So you might be thinking, well then, a film can still be funny without cursing all the time, so how are the actual jokes? Well, my friend, I can safely say that the jokes in this film are really not that great. Yeah, I'm dead serious. I expected this film to be a lot funnier than it actually was, considering just how funny people built it up to be and how excellent in terms of comedy the cast was. And the most unfunny thing, surprisingly, was the act of Rudy Ray Moore himself. All of his comedic performances as the titular Dolemite were really unfunny. Now, I'm sure his act was hilarious in the 70s and not the best target for a 2020 cynic like myself, so I give it a slight pass when it came to other things, but there was also another aspect of Rudy Ray Moore I wasn't a fan of. Number three, Rudy Ray Moore's backstory. Despite this film being based off a true story, I still expect there to be some good explanation of Rudy Ray Moore's life and, you know, everything up until this point, pre-Dolemite, for those who might not have the best info on it, like myself, who just kind of went in blind. And the film does a decent job at that towards the beginning, which does help welcome us into the world, and I was fine with it. But the problem is that smack dab in the middle of the movie, right the hell out of nowhere, might I add, he just starts talking about his dad and his childhood life, which leaves me asking, where the hell was that at the start of the film? Having that wrinkle in his character and explaining it earlier, really going deep into his lineage and learning where he came from, it would have helped us get on Rudy's side a lot quicker and made his eventual success so much more enjoyable to the average viewer. And if they moved that story to the beginning, then they could have used that scene that came right the hell out of nowhere and explained that story for jokes that, you know, were actually funny. Big missed opportunity for the staff, and that leads us right into the bottom line. The bottom line. Dolemite Is My Name is a fun and, yes, uplifting ride through 1970s filmmaking with a great atmosphere and cast that draws you into the wonderful world of 70s Hollywood. However, the over-reliance on cursing, unfunny humor, and missed opportunities from a vital backstory point leave this film in the dust behind some of the better and more innovative 2000s comedies. But for what it is, it's an alright watch. I'm gonna give Dolemite Is My Name 3.5 stars. Thank you guys so much for watching. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Look out for all the videos coming on the Raider News channel. My name is Ben Friedman. Stay safe, and I'll see you next time.